In the past year, year and a half or so, I've been much more involved in the world of Warhammer 40,000 or 40K, whatever. It's very interesting with all the setting and all the factions and their interactions and whatnot. And the war game is something I've always had a passing interest in, but at the time when I started learning more about it, I like just got out of high school, and high school kids, you know, kind of broke as fuck. So it's something I kind of had a passing interest in, but I never really got much into. But in the past year, I've gotten more into the setting and learning more about it. And I'm like, hey, this is pretty cool stuff. This is what people have been doing for in this hobby for the past 30 years or so, and I finally know about it. And as of recording, the current edition is 8th edition, not to date this video too much. But Kill Team has come out during this edition's lifetime, and I've always been more interested in smaller games because I've just been more, I don't want to spend so much money. And when Kill Team came out and I looked at the max point value, it's like 100 points, mostly troop choices. And I'm like, hey, you know, this is pretty cool. I figured, hey, you might as well try playing a little Kill Team. So I got a Death Watch team like everybody else did, and I set up my five dudes, blew up some Necron, it was great. And then it occurred to me that with the small cost and size of these squads, I could be experimenting more and more. Now, before I got into all of this, I did have a little bit of modeling experience, but I had never had a reason to use it, and I just kind of made little one-off art pieces, I guess. But with Kill Team out, it occurred to me I could make things for a reason and justify the price to myself, so I didn't feel so bad about buying random shit all the time. And one of my favorite things to do is take one thing I like and merge it with another. So I took this opportunity to implement into a setting that is already very receptive to fanfic, I guess you would call it. Writing your own stories. And I decided to add in something from a series I love very dear to my heart, which is the Metroid series. And I took this opportunity to make a group of space pirates from the Metroid series as a playable kill team in 8th edition Warhammer 40,000 kill team. So the first thing I had to do was work out the rules. Like, what am I going to build? How am I going to build it? And it made me think about what the space pirates were in general. The space pirates in Metroid are some of the main antagonists of the entire series. Mother Brain, Ridley, the whole nine yards. They are ruthless and antagonistic and bloodthirsty. They love physical combat. They destroy and pillage. They use an entire fleet of ramshackled and busted machinery, and they'll load up a couple of dudes in it and send them out like, have fun, good luck. The main thing that comes to mind when I think of that are the boarding pods the space pirates used in the beginning of Metroid Prime 3, when after Samus is doing her whole shebang, walking through the Olympus looking like a rock star, and then boom, hit by space pirates. Those boarding pods are known through the pirates as super dangerous. It doesn't matter, they still use them, that's still standard equipment for them. And above everything else, the space pirates follow strength. That's why Ridley is not only super powerful, but why he commands all the space pirates under an iron fist. So it's not hard to put the pieces together when I'm thinking about the space pirates, what rules they could use in Kill Team, and they would make a perfect fit for Eldar. Just kidding. Eldar belong in the trash, honestly. No, they make perfect orcs. After a little bit of poking around with the materials I had and all the minis I had bought, I eventually settled for this. My leader is going to be a commando boss knob, and I've got 3 Bernas, a Luda, and 5 orc boys. And altogether, that's 11 models. And now that I have the 11 models chosen and worked out, now I know how many things I need to model and work on. So now that I had a bit of direction, I could choose where to start and where to go, and I was essentially ready to tackle the project. After doing a lot of hunting around for minis, I decided on some minis made by Mantic Games called the Locust City Chiefs. They're like these They're called the Zizor. They look like Bugmen. And I figured the center mass of that model would be absolutely perfect as a starting point. So I ordered some, and when they came in, they were pre-assembled and on a clear hexagonal base, which was a little weird to me. So I took a second to remove them off of the bases. Some of them needed to be cut off, combination of prying, pulling, and scraping. One of them just kind of popped off on me. After removing the models from the bases, I went through for all the models and I cut off all the arms, and some of them had heads that I wanted to keep or for a little while, and then after a while I decided I wasn't having it. I just cut those heads off too. Every time I do a project, if I can, try to learn something new. And this was the first project I had started using blue stuff, or Oyumaru. And blue stuff is essentially a thermoplastic. What that means is when you put it in hot water or something, it becomes moldable and malleable. And whenever it cools off, it retains its shape. And a lot of people use this in the mini community to make their own two-piece molds. I decided, hey, you know what, let's give it a try. I wanted to recast some heads so everybody would have a matching semi-uniform head. I wanted to recast the gun that I was going to be using on their arm. It was a Combi Melta piece that came with my Death Watch set, and I thought it looked perfect for the galvanic arm cannon. So I decided, hey, if I could recast these, it'd be great. And I made a big error in using Milliput Fine White. Where is this? Super Fine White. This shit. Biggest fucking mistake. I understand that it says super fine white, but having the two component pieces of your two-part epoxy being white and kind of like a pale off-white makes it kind of hard to mix. And it was the first time I used that Milliput, and I mixed it together. I'm no idiot. I can mix A and B, okay? But I sat there and I gave it a good little massaging, and no matter what I did, all of those pieces that I had put into the molds, they never cured all the way, even though I thought I had properly fucking mixed them. Now, granted, the Milliput did come out of the mold very easily. Like, I was worried about it at first, but after it cured, it just popped right out. I was like, great. But the Milliput was an absolute nightmare to work with. So I decided to go with the tried and true green stuff, or knead it tight, whatever you want to call it. I put it in the mold. 4 hours later, I took it out. It was nice and cure. Didn't leave any resin behind. Great. In the future, I am going to opt to use green stuff for this process over Milliput Superfine. Because fuck that. While I was doing these two-part molds, and I decided to start working on the arm. Some of the arms needed adjusting. Some of them really didn't. Say if I wanted a bend, you know, I'd cut that in. I wanted to straighten an arm out, I'd cut the notch out and work on that. But the main thing, when it comes to making models, I like the core of my model to be sturdy. So I opted to pin as many things as possible to each other. If I cut an arm in half somewhere to readjust it, I pin the bitch. All the arms attaching to the pirate, I pin the bitch. For those who don't know, pinning is essentially drilling a small hole in the two pieces you want to connect and putting a small piece of metal rod, like a paperclip or something, in between them, affixed by some super glue on the metal rod. And what this does is makes it extremely sturdy. You have to actively try to get that piece undone again. If I could pin something, I did. The only thing I really didn't pin were the energy sides on the left arm. Everything was pinned. The model to the base, pinned. But after I got all that worked out, I organized all the pieces and I went ahead and cut out a energy scythe template out of a piece of paper. That way I could go through with a piece of plastic card and trace out more energy sides and have a bunch of somewhat matching weaponry. After all the arms were pinned on and everything was in position, I decided to move on to the armor, or the chest armor of these pirates. They have these kind of weird ring things over the shoulder chest area? I don't even know what to call them, honestly. I sat around thinking for a while, thinking, what would be the best way to do this? And I was walking through Hobby Lobby one day, and I found these 12mm metal rings that they use for, like, jewelry. And I thought, well, might as well give it a try. And upon getting home, I noticed they were a perfect size. So, whoop-de-doo. However, they were beyond a pain in the ass to keep in place. In the usual case, the metal ring wouldn't stick into place, so I used a little bit of green stuff, put it on there. That didn't stick, so I had to take it back off, put some super glue, put it down there. It essentially was a fucking nightmare. If I were to be doing this again sometime in the future, I would definitely try to use plastic rings. I just used what I first saw, and I went with it, and I was getting a little impatient because I couldn't find anything. So I went with metal, didn't really work out. I'd try plastic in the future. And at this point, I was getting a little burned out with the project, honestly. As much as I like Metroid, as much as I like Space Pirates, and as much as I like chopping up little plastic aliens, as much as the next guy, this project had come stretched out to almost a month's time of just like a little bit of work a day and then off, and I didn't have a lot of molds to use with the limited blue stuff I had, so the recasting was taking really long. Honestly, I filled up all those molds twice with the Milliput and figured, oh shit, this isn't working out well, because I noticed they weren't curing. Then I had to go back and redo that entire step of green stuff. The results I got with the green stuff were a bit shaky because, like I said, this was my first time making these two-part molds and recasting. So some of the heads came out a little funky. I put a little too much green stuff in the molds, so a lot of the guns were a little wider in some parts than they should be. If you were looking at it casually, you might say, it looks pretty good. But when I look at it, I can see it immediately. But I think that kind of goes for everybody making their own things. In my haste to get this done, I forgot to record myself recasting the combi meltas entirely, but this was, as much as I like the project and I like how it came out and I love the idea and the theme behind it, I was ready to be fucking over with. And I think that's an important part that people have to learn about their projects, is that spending too long on them may net you results that you're not happy with, just as if you were trying to speed through it. You have to find the right amount of time to give yourself so you don't burn out and you don't rush it. Like, learning yourself and how you model and how you paint are definitely helps, but at this point, I've become sick and fucking tired of Space Pirate. Now, before I get into talking about what I did with the painting, I want to talk to you about what I actually modeled. I have two types of pirates. I have the Space Pirates that you see from Metroid Prime 1 specifically. The other ones you see in my squad, they are the Pirate Commandos, but they are specifically from Metroid Prime 2 Echoes. Now, I was really abrasive about mixing Metroid Prime 1 and Metroid Prime 2, but after looking at the specialty pirates from the first one, like the Plasma Trooper and the goofiest fuck troopers, spoiler alert, all of them, except the Shadow Pirate, those are kind of cool, I decided to replace those specialty troopers with the Pirate Commandos, and I also really like the look of them. This is my project, so whatever. For all the pirates, they got primed black. I used normal Krylon flat black primer. People say Krylon is bad, but I've been using Krylon for years. I've never had a problem with it. The standard pirates, how I started them off is, first I did a base coat of Vallejo flat green. Then I went through and I plucked out all the purple areas with Vallejo royal purple. Then I cleaned it up with flat green. In retrospect, it would probably be easier just to do purple first and then throw the green on top of it. But hey, hindsight, 2020. That's what I'm here to do on these projects, is to learn. After I got all the base coats established, I decided to do the first dry brush. On the purple areas, I gave them a 1-to-1 dry brush of Vallejo blue violet and Vallejo green blue. Because I noticed that, or a friend of mine noticed, the purple skinnish areas of the Space Pirates have kind of a bluish, a color we could only describe as periwinkle. After that, I gave the green areas a dry brush for a 2-to-1 mixture, two parts Vallejo yellow with one part flat green. Now, after the dry brush, all the colors were a little too bright on it, but I still had to get some depth on the model. So I decided to use a 1-to-1 mixture of Games Workshop's Nuln Oil with Lamine Medium, Glaze Medium, or even just water. Normally you don't use water in glaze mixtures, but for small areas, it's okay. Now, for the eyes of a space pirate are kind of like this yellow. For the eyes, I decided to try something different. I went with Games Workshop Celestra Gray on the eyes, and then I hit it with Cassandora Yellow shade, and it came out decently nice, but I wanted it darker around the edges than it had come out. I decided to put another small dot of Celestra Gray and then shade it again. So not only did I have that first color that I really liked on the middle of the eye, I still had this outline, and I think it came out pretty nice. For the scythe, I liked the color of that, and I did the same thing. I gave it a base coat of Celestra Gray, and then I gave it two coats of Cassandora Yellow. After I put down the Celestra Gray, I went in with the Cassandora Yellow, and then after it dried all the way, I put on the second coat, but focused it towards the base of the scythe, and it gave it a nice orange to yellow transition, I think it came out pretty all right. Certainly better than trying to paint an energy effect onto the sword, as I'm pretty crappy when it comes to that. I decided to edge highlight it with Games Workshop's Screaming Skull. It matched pretty well. And at the very tips of the energy blade, I put a tiny bit of white at the ends of the sides, and I think it came out pretty all right. Now for the commandos, as I've already primed them black, they were already mostly black. However, I did, before I started this, go back through with a thinned down black, and I hit all the spots that my primer had missed. And afterwards, I decided to give the arms and the legs a base coat in Games Workshop's Eschen Gray. After I got that base coat down, I gave it a dry brush of Celestra Gray, and then shade the areas I had dry brushed with a 1-to-1 mixture of glaze medium and known oil, the same one I used earlier. Afterwards, it was just a matter of highlighting all the black parts with a 2-to-1 mixture of Eschen Gray and your choice of white paint. I used Vallejo because Game Workshop couldn't make a good white paint if you put a gun to their head. And afterwards, it was a matter of going through and drawing in all the white details. Now for the bases I had struggled with for the entire project, because I wanted them to resemble the insides of the frigate Orpheum, the tutorial area of Metroid Prime 1. According to the scan logs in the Metroid Prime series, Orpheum was one of three ships that had moved out of orbit when Zebes exploded. There was Orpheum, there was Volparagon, and then Sicarius? I don't know, put that on screen. In my head, because the only one you ever hear about is Orpheon. It's like, how could I justify these boys being here in the 41st millennia? They were the crew of the Volparagon that got sucked through a warp storm, and now on the Volparagon science vessel, they have to not only survive in the setting of 40k, but try to hopefully find their way back. So I wanted the bases to resemble the frigate Orpheon, but the thing is, I could not for the fucking life of me get a base that I liked. So after trying maybe 8 different times to find something I liked, I just said, fuck it. I primed that bitch black, I stabbed at it with a sponge with some iron breaker on it, and then some Rhinox hide and some spots to make it look a little dirty, and then I kind of threw a little known oil on there to make it look kind of oily. It came out a little dirtier than I wanted to. In retrospect, that's kind of what I get for using iron breaker, but hey, they're just the bases, and they're really simple bases too. They're just plastic cards, plastic glued onto some normal Games Workshop bases. If I want to redo them in the future, then I can super easily. All the minis are attached with the same pinning technique I mentioned earlier. Not only does it make them pretty sturdy and allow me to paint the mini and the base separately, if I want to separate them in the future, I can stick them in the freezer, and the cold temperature will help the super glue become more brittle and break off a lot easier. So if I ever want to do that in the future, I can throw that bitch in the freezer for like 2 hours and then snap it off and go from there. That was the project in a nutshell. I am both very glad and very upset with how it came out. I'm very glad because I like the Metroid. I'm a big Metroid fan. I would be wearing my Metroid shirt if I didn't forget to put it on, but right now I got Britney Spears. And I'm very upset with it because I tend to be kind of critical when it comes to my own projects, and it's something I've been trying to work on. This ain't too bad. But on the other hand, it's like, hey, this looks like actual dog shit. That's the point about these projects and working on them over time, and something I hope to learn by keeping track of these projects as I make them, not only to help serve as a guide to refer to if I want to go back to past projects, but something to kind of look at from time to time and reorient myself and try to get things in perspective. I think perspective is very important when it comes to not just miniature art or wargaming in general, anything you make in general. Fuck, I should have written a script. But yeah, that was my first project for the lab. Hopefully you guys enjoyed the video and stick around. I do have another project coming up, and I'm really excited to get working on that one. Yeah, thanks for watching. Bye.